Welcome to Eyes on Hawaii, on the ThinkTech live streaming network series broadcasting from our downtown studio at Pioneer Plaza at the core of downtown Honolulu. I'm your host, Carroll Cox. Joining me in the studios is Cathy Goeggel. Today we're going to talk about Ms. Goeggel's role as an advocate for animals. Remember that our talk shows are streamed live on the internet from 12 noon to 5 p.m. every weekday, and earlier shows are streamed all night long. All our shows are streamed on livestream.com if you want the links to our live streams or previous broadcasts, which are available on youtube.com, or if you want to subscribe to our programs or get on our mailing list and get our program advisors, go to thinktechhawaii.com. If you want to pose a question or a comment during one of our shows, please tweet us at ThinkTechHawaii. ThinkTechHawaii. Okay, so welcome aboard, Cathy Goeggel.
Thanks so much for having me, Carol.
Yes, ma'am. I really appreciate it. You are the president of and founder, one of the founders of...
I'm one of the founders of Animal Rights Hawaii. We were founded in 1977, and we are one of the oldest animal rights organizations in the world. And we are also, and have always been, all volunteers.
Mm-hmm. And you're statewide, are you? Or you do things also internationally?
We work on international issues, we work on national issues, and of course, local issues.
And when were you founded?
1977. So we've been around for quite a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Before PETA, even.
Before PETA, that's
yes.
Right. They're really young compared to coming on the scene. So now I can think back many issues that were worldwide and drew international attention, and that was Canadian seal killing. And I'm sure, and I recall you having some role in that and participating. What happened with that, and how were you involved?
That was one of our earliest protests. We had a parade in Waikiki. It was actually a seal funeral, and we were protesting the killing of the harp seal pups for their fur in a very, very cruel manner in the spring. And actually, it's still going on, and it's going on right now. As the ice breaks up, the ships can bring the sealers in close to where the pups are, and they kill them with what's called a hackapick. It's a very hard, long, sharp, nasty hook,
mm-hmm.
and the animals are left to just bleed out on the ice, and their skins are taken.
So now they're just taken, killed for their fur.
For their fur,
and
yes.
For fur coats and lining of seats and cars and vehicles and what?
Yes.
Is that correct?
That's correct, even though the European Union does not allow the import of fur from these animals anymore. The U.S. doesn't allow the import. It's just an anachronism, and we have been fighting against it, as I said, for many years.
Mm-hmm. Now, coming back local here, you have done many things on dolphin, cetacean captivity. You've protested the zoo, many things, and if you could just share with my viewers what it is that you've done and to what degree. Have you had an impact? Can you, a measurable impact?
I believe that we have. One of the things that we worked on very, very hard was livestock transport. Hawaii raises cattle and they are shipped to the mainland for
mm-hmm.
slaughter. But even worse, live pigs are brought in, used to be from Canada, now it's from the middle of the United States, Nebraska, the Dakotas, those states. They are shipped all the way by truck until mm-hmm. they get to the West Coast, and then on Matson ships to Hawaii just to provide what's called hot pork, mm-hmm. unrefrigerated flesh of a slaughtered pig.
Mm-hmm.
For certain markets. We worked on this for many years. We worked with some international organizations, and we were happy to to have Time Supermarket and Foodland Supermarket commit to no longer using or selling pork from animals who have undergone that long, horrible journey. Mm-hmm. So that's one of our, what we're really proud of.
Now, talking about shipment of animals and live animals and livestock, what are some of the concerns? Is there hardships associated with this shipping? And you mentioned a bit of it, but what are these animals experiencing? And so that people don't draw the conclusion that, well, we are sensitive for the wrong reasons. Can you share with us?
Oh, well, absolutely. They are not coming on a cruise ship. They are in what are called livestock containers, double-decker, so that all of the urine and excrement from the pigs above lands on the pigs below. Pigs get seasick. A lot of pigs die en route. We have been getting the livestock import permits from the state of Hawaii for the past 15 years. Every month we check how many pigs are coming in and how many died. They die from heat exhaustion. They die from starvation sometimes because they run out of food on the trip. It is absolutely unnecessary. If people need to eat pork, it can come from animals raised and slaughtered on the mainland.
So you're looking more so the humane treatment of all of these animals, where they are destined for the dinner table, or you also on many occasions have raised issues and had an influence on show animals, bears and donkeys, diving mules, and what I recall years back having conversation with you about the diving mules. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, we have protested animals at the 50th State Fair, the Animal Act, for many, many years. The Diving Mule Act was run by a man named Tim Rivers, and we actually tried to get a TRO against him. Unfortunately, the judge didn't rule in our favor, and Mr. Rivers went ahead that had his mules climb up this long, long, long ramp up to the top, and very often he would have a monkey tied to the mule, and then it would dive into a pool of water, and above, like an above-the-ground swimming pool. Mr. Rivers was convicted in a federal sting a few years later, along with several of his companions, for shooting endangered species in their cages and selling their furs. So he spent some time in federal prison, not for the Diving Mule Act, but I'm happy to know that he is out of business right now.
So the central theme is animal welfare, animal cruelty, and when we, just for entertainment, for example, it's rather costly for the animal. And most people are sensitive to that. And you don't have to be an animal rights activist, or as some people say, whether they call them a peter, whatever it is, but it's a negative connotation. But animals do have the right to be protected and cared for and not abused for our entertainment. If we're going to legitimately consume them, if that's the accepted practice, but all of the side issues of them standing in the urine, sore feet, moving in contained trailers, as we know, for example, where they come in from out island, for example, cows, and then they're placed on the tarmac there at Sand Island, waiting to be picked up or put back on a boat or wherever they're going or their destination. How do they feed them in between? If they shipped them from the Big Island and they subsequently are destined for the mainland and other places, is that a practice?
Well, if they're brought in and then they're placed on this blasted, heat-blasted piece of property at Sand Island, there is usually a caretaker and some food is thrown into them and a water hose is provided. But those metal boxes retain the heat terribly. Mm-hmm. And we would like to see an end to livestock transport. We have petitioned Mattson several times. They don't even respond to our letters. But with regard to entertainment animals, I'm sure everybody remembers Tyke the elephant, who was gunned down with 87 bullets in 1994. Mm-hmm. She had escaped from the circus at Blaisdell. She killed her handler. And at that point, we decided that we were going to, this was going to be a major, major issue for us. And we have been working, trying to get legislation passed, both at the city council level and at the state level for many years. And finally, we have upcoming in May, just in a few days, public hearings on changes in the administrative rules for the Department of Agriculture, the State Department of Agriculture, that would prohibit the import of dangerous wild animals for display or shows. And this does not include the zoo, so zoos are excluded from this rule. There are going to be public hearings on all of the islands, and we hope that animal lovers on all the islands will come out and speak, and if they can't come out, they can send in testimony and they can visit our Facebook page, which is Animal Rights Hawaii, and find out how to send in their testimony.
And it's unfortunate, if we look back, these animals, the tyke and the cetaceans or the killer whale, false killer whales or the killer whales, they have a common theme or a common thread. People have, the advocacy groups have always tried to encourage or discourage housing these animals and containing them because they are wild animals, number one. But a bigger problem is, and I think what it's unfortunate, but it happened this way, is that in each occasion someone died. For example, the person that was handling the cetacean or the killer whale was drowned or killed. And then there's tyke, and there's other instances where animals have been found to injure people while they were originally to be entertaining. So it's unfortunate that it has resulted in the death of human beings, but that seems to elevate it. Then it's as if someone gets the point.
Well, hopefully somebody gets the point.
But should it take that, you know? I mean,
it
such a tragic.
It shouldn't take that. It really shouldn't. People should realize that elephants in the wild travel many, many miles during a day, and elephants in circuses are chained up 23 hours a day. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, Ringling Brothers is closing down, and we hope that some of the other circuses that still use elephants will stop using them, and also other dangerous animals, lions, tigers, bears, they all have particular needs in order to live a decent life. Mm-hmm. And traveling shows does not provide anything good for them.
And so often this vivid picture of this tiger or this bear or this wild animal walking back and forth, pacing back. Imagine being housed in a small cage and there and many people coming, and animals don't like to look at one another in the eye. I mean, it's showing down, and here's hundreds of eyes per day staring at thousands of eyes. We don't quite understand the psychology of animals, but we do know that many of them on many occasions do in fact start to act abnormally as what they, when I say abnormal, they've been trained to do. But most of that is forced, and to get an animal to do tricks, what do you say about the actions taken to get an animal, to an elephant, to stand on his head? What does that involve?
It involves usually taking a very young elephant, chaining them down, and beating them. Beating them with clubs and with what's called a bull hook. It's also called an ankus. It has a very sharp hook on it, and elephants there are places on their bodies, particularly under their legs where the skin is not so thick, that is very painful for them. So that's how they're trained, that not only for shows, but for elephant rides and elephant polo and all those stupid tricks. Even on roller skates, elephants on roller skates, it's just crazy.
Mm-hmm. Depressing in one sense. And so, okay, we're going to take a short break. And I'm Carroll Cox. This is the Eyes on Hawaii ThinkTech Live streaming network series. We're talking with Ms. Cathy Goeggel about animals and their welfare. We'll be back in a minute. So stay tuned for more of the story.
Thank you for watching ThinkTech. I'm Grace Chang, the new host for Global Connections. You can find me here live every Thursday at 1 p.m., where we'll be talking to people around the islands or visiting the islands who are connected in various aspects of global affairs. So please tune in, and aloha, and thanks for watching.
Hello, I'm Dean Nelson, host of Planet of the Courageous. From a Tibetan point of view, we chose to be on this planet because we enrolled in a sort of graduate school for courage. Just that we may have chosen this adventure is a leap of logic. The question is, how do we spend and make sense of this precious human life? We are, as a species, extraordinarily successful, dominating the planet, and now with planetary-sized problems that our existence itself has created. It takes courage to face not only the uncertainty of life, but also the challenge of sustaining the gift of life for future generations. Join us every other Monday at 3 p.m. on ThinkTech Hawaii. Aloha.
We're back. We're live. I'm Carroll Cox, and this is Eyes on Hawaii on the ThinkTech Live Streaming Network series, talking about animal rights and their welfare. So, Cathy Goeggel, I really appreciate you taking the time. I've always wanted to corner you and say, come in, let's sit and talk about this and share, because, you know, the slightest overt act where a person might suggest that maybe we should review how we treat animals, or maybe you become labeled as a person who's an extremist. So there's this great danger where if you say to them, well, we really shouldn't put things in captivity, or we shouldn't, to take a chimpanzee and train it, how many young chimpanzees or how many adult chimpanzees lose their lives just to get this to happen?
Well, we don't know how many, but it's quite obvious that the wildlife in Africa particularly are suffering greatly from habitat loss, but also from the bushmeat trade and from people wanting to take them and sell them as pets.
Mm-hmm.
So we are totally opposed to that.
Mm-hmm. So now we have cetaceans in captivity,
mm-hmm.
and the ultimate message that you and others want to get out there is that even in the consumption of animals, is that right? You are vegan or vegetarian?
Yes, I am. Yes.
And you advocate for that. Then what's the benefit to that, and why would you educate and to tell people that they shouldn't eat animals or meat products?
Well, we advocate a plant-based diet, and since we're so close to Earth Day, I think it's really appropriate that we discuss this issue. When forests are cleared, such as in South America, where the Amazon forest is disappearing, it's being cleared for cattle to graze. The amount of time, the amount of energy that goes into producing a pound of meat, the amount of water that goes into producing a pound of meat is horribly, horribly high. It is so much better to raise food directly to feed people. We talk about sustainability here in Hawaii. The livestock industry here has been living off the taxpayers for many, many years. I've been monitoring the legislature, and and we have bought them lots of stuff. Mm-hmm. The livestock industry here has no future without great infusions of taxpayer money. Mm-hmm. It would be far better if we are truly dedicated to being sustainable, that we raise our own food to feed to people, mm-hmm. not to cattle.
And that's two more shows down the road. But, you know, in regards to South America and more specifically, just recently in the news, they have stated that Brazil has outgrown America in its production agriculture-wise. And the reason given is that a lot of the land has been cleared for soybean. Hint, soy milk, soy products. So mm-hmm. so there's a great danger if there's a balance that need to be stricken, struck here. In while advocating for that, what do you say about that as to do we want to focus solely on soy milk and create these things, or as a diet to vary it and make it a variety of foods to consume? And how do we avoid contributing to such a situation in Brazil, wanting the need to produce soy milk?
Well, Mark, everything is market driven. And quite frankly, I don't like soy milk. I prefer almond milk, coconut milk, cashew milk is really delicious. But each time a new product like that comes up, then of course there's going to be someone who wants to grow those things.
Yeah.
Palm oil in Indonesia is destroying the forest because people want to use palm oil. Orangutan habitat is disappearing. I really don't have an answer
right.
for
and
you that, on
that's
that.
That's the dilemma that we find ourselves in, because we know we need to do something, but how do, with all these mechanisms in place, how do we gauge it and how we regulate it and the need, because just one of them send a spike up and demand the resources attributed to that. But coming back here to Hawaii, for example, the question or even about dairies and the production of dairies, and one would have to ask, the environmental impacts, are they worth it for a gallon of milk? We just casually say a gallon. Clearly, it's more than a gallon of milk involved.
Yes.
One company said they produce in a year's time 4 million gallons, or the equivalent of 5 days of milk flowing over the Rainbow Falls in Hilo for,
well,
5 days.
My response to that would be, yes, you're producing many million gallons of milk, but you're also producing many million gallons of cow poop, manure that goes into what they call euphemistically lagoons, which produce methane, mm-hmm. and can overflow during our rainy season and can trickle down into our water supply. And the same thing happens with pig farms as well. Mm-hmm. But we do have some intensive CAFOs, confined animal feeding operations here in Hawaii for pigs and for dairy. So my feeling is that, again, livestock agriculture in Hawaii becomes corporate welfare. And we're our state. We have a hard time providing for our children in schools. We have a hard time providing for the homeless. We have health care to worry about. Mm-hmm. I think that if an industry is to survive, it should be able to do so on its own. And I'd like to see the legislature stop hemorrhaging money into the livestock industry.
Well, interesting you talk about hemorrhaging and subsidizing. Just recently, and I won't name the company, but there's a dairy, and to buy a half a gallon of its milk, it's locally produced, this dairy produces the milk, and they sell it in the stores, many of the big chain stores, for on sale $5.48 a half a gallon, or $5.49. Some places $5.99 a half a gallon. Now that's what would a whole gallon cost you? Add it up. When you can get the same or milk product from some of the box chain stores, like around for $5 or $4.50 a gallon. Not that I'm advocating for drinking milk, but clearly, how does one justify, our legislators justify subsidizing that kind and claiming local sustainable, and it's going to fuel the economy? But that's rather extreme cost or high cost to pay, and to say that it's sustainable. Is it really sustainable?
No, it's not sustainable at all. And I've been at the legislature and saying that over and over again, but there are lobbyists for this industry.
Well, I did a little segue into that to say that, could you tell us about your legislative lobbying and what you do, what do you go through, and what some of the bills that you've, I'm just trying to bring it back home if you could, what are some of the bills that you've actually been supporting and advocating for over the years? And do we recognize any of those now that are in place? And what are some of the new ones?
Well, one of some of the recent ones, we supported the ivory ban. And we are very, very happy that Hawaii has banned the import and sale of ivory. That's very important. I also have participated in many, many legislative hearings on invasive species, as well as protection for our endangered species.
Well, it's clearly you've done a lot of work, and a lot of work ahead of you. So I would say the elephant ban is a really good thing, because to get an ivory, you are killing an elephant. They don't just cut them off, and whether it's rhino horns or rhinoceros horns and what have you, to make colorful statues or stamps and whatever. It's just unreasonable and just really a sad situation. But I really appreciate you taking the time and joining me. Is there anything real quick? How does one reach you real quickly?
Well, through our Facebook page would be the best way.
And that is?
Animal Rights Hawaii. Mm-hmm. And check us out. We have a Twitter account and also Instagram.
Mm-hmm. And is it open to public joining, or do you solicit membership? Or
We don't really have members. We have supporters. Mm-hmm. We have a website, but it was hacked by someone in Malaysia a couple of years ago. So we haven't put it up again.
Okay. Well, I really appreciate you joining us. And we're going to say that basically this has come to the end, and it's just so much to talk about. And okay, and I appreciate it, and we're out of time, and we'll have to wrap it up. I'm Carroll Cox. This is Eyes on Hawaii on the ThinkTech Live Streaming Network series. We've been talking with Ms. Cathy Goeggel about advocating for welfare of animals. Thanks to you, Ms. Cathy Goeggel, for being here with me. Thanks to our broadcast engineer, Robert McLean, our floor manager, and to Jay Fidel, our executive producer, who puts this all together. And thanks to you and our viewers and listeners. If you want to get our email and social media program advisors, click the link on thinktechhawaii.com. If you'd like to be a guest, an underwriter, or a volunteer, or if you want to join us in our downtown studio in Pioneer Plaza, contact Jay at thinktechhawaii.com. If you want the links to our live streams on our previous broadcasts on Ustream TV or YouTube.com, just go to thinktechhawaii.com. Go there to our Facebook and page and tell them you like us. We'd love you to like us. And of course, I'll see you next week, Tuesday at 12 noon, for more on Eyes on Hawaii. On ThinkTech, I'm Carroll Cox, and aloha, everyone.